To tell us his expectations from the president's second sauna, we have with us Professor Dennis Coronacion, the chairman of the Political Science Department of the University of Santo Tomas. Professor, thank you for joining us once again in the program.
Well, it's a pleasure being here with you. Good afternoon.
Hi, good afternoon, Professor. Let's go now to, we're days, of course, days before the second sauna of our president. Let's start breaking down what happened for the past year. Let's start first with the foreign policy. How will you grade it, and what are you expecting will be in his sauna about this?
Well, I think this is one of the areas where the president has really, achieved a lot. Mm-hmm. Since what he has been trying to do here in this area is that he has been trying to make up for what the country had lost during the time of his predecessor. Remember that his predecessor's pro-China policy was considered by many as a failure, in the sense that the former President Duterte wasn't able to maximize profit he saw, whatever benefit he thought would the country would have by going very close with China. And so the current president is trying to fix the problem and trying to keep our traditional ally, the United States, back in the fold. Mm-hmm. So that's in the area of foreign policy.
Okay, so what are you expecting? Is he going to be adding on the sauna about this issue? Will he be giving us more about this? Because the day after, he will be visiting Malaysia.
Well, I think he's going to, delve in that area. I think he's going to tell us the achievements and benefits of his travels to the other countries, like in the Southeast Asian countries, and his visit to the United States, and he would explain to us the benefits that the country has gotten from those visits. And I think he's also going to justify why he had to modify a bit the policy of his predecessor.
Mm-hmm. What about on militarization, Professor, and the West Philippine Sea issue? Do you think that there has to have more communication on this part?
Well, I don't think that the president is going to tell us, his strategy regarding the national security. But the president can do so, since everyone, I think, there's a lot of Filipinos who are getting scared with the report that China has this plan of invading Taiwan. Whether or not it's true, the president, I think, has to allay the fear of most Filipinos that the Philippines is going to get caught, if there's going to be a military action between the two major powers, U.S. and China. At least the president should tell us what his plan is going to be.
Mm-hmm. Let's go now to human rights, the drug war, and the recent ICC development on the investigation of the war on drugs by the previous administration. How do you think the president, President Marcos, has dealt with this on the first year, and what are you expecting will be part of his speech on Monday?
Well, his policy regarding that one, especially the case that was filed against the former president and Senator Bato de la Rosa, I think he has already articulated his policy through the DOJ secretary, which is a continuation actually of the former administration's policy that the ICC should not intervene in the internal affairs, especially the case of the former president, since their argument is that we have well-functioning institutions, particularly in the Justice Department and our courts. So that's their argument, and they continue to believe so. Now, I think the president should worry about the image that this would generate in the international community. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I think it's important that he should come up he should be able to produce a positive image, considering the fact that in another aspect, he's trying to gain the consensus and support of the international community when it comes to the decision of the permanent tribunal. So the president should be able to do everything in order to woo the support of the international community in all aspects.
Mm-hmm. Since you mentioned that, that's a good point that you mentioned, Professor, that the president has to at least take a stand on this and how the Philippines will be viewed when it comes to the international community, because we're trying to make the Philippines a business hub. If the Philippines would be going back and forth on their stand with the ICC, what do you think this will affect when it comes to investors, business investors for the country?
Well, it's important that the president should show a positive image about the Philippines, especially for the investors. Remember that the one that's being tried by the ICC is the former president, and that he was being accused of abusing his power and going beyond the rule of law. So remember that investors, business investors, are before they would invest in a country, they would look at the stability in the country. So if they have, if they would notice that the political elites in a given country would be spared from from punishment and penalties if they transgress or if they violate the laws, then I don't think it's going to create a positive image for the Philippines. Mm-hmm. So the so-called culture of impunity, this rule of law, all of these things should be, especially rule of law, this should be observed. We should be adhered to so that we can, we can attract more investors. Show the rest of the world that this is a stable country and a good country to invest in.
Mm-hmm. Since we already touched on the issue of human rights, let's go now to what the international group Human Rights Watch is saying, that the Philippines, when it came to the start of the administration of the president, has had a lack of progress when it comes to red tagging. From what happened in the past year, we have seen even the vice president red tagging some rights groups here in the country. What do you think should be included in the president's speech?
Well, I don't think that the president's going to give priority in terms of changing that policy. It's a policy that he had, that he has inherited, that he has decided to continue from the past administration, considering that the vice president is the daughter of former President Duterte. So I think the same policy is going to continue. There's not going to be any major change. Mm-hmm. That policy, except that perhaps there's going to be a difference in terms of the degree of implementing the red tagging and the red campaign, anti-communist campaign. Mm-hmm. So, because I don't think at the moment that's the priority of President Bongbong Marcos. Mm-hmm. It may be the priority of the vice president, but not for President Bongbong Marcos.
So do you think he shouldn't also address the number of media personnel who were killed on months into his administration?
I think he should, since many are doubting his commitment to Philippine democracy because of his ties, blood ties with the former dictator. Mm-hmm. So many would doubt that he would be very serious in making the Philippines a healthy democracy. But he has every chance. He's going to be given so many chances to prove his critics and his opponents wrong. So this is one of those chances to prove that he is for a healthy Philippine democracy, and that he will not be like his father.
Let's go now to the legislation that he signed over the first year. There were six that the president signed. Of these six, only three out of came from the 42 priority bills proposed by LEDA. The people are asking why only three of the 42, and the other three are not even part of the priority bills.
Well, this is concerning. You're right, no? This is concerning, considering the fact that his administration is the one that's in charge of getting this country out of the problems that have been generated by the pandemic. So he must have this sense of urgency solving the pressing problems of this country. But then again, we should think that we should be aware that the president, you know, in coming up with laws, is not alone, that he is joined by Congress. So Congress may be an ally. Most of the members of Congress are his ally. But then again, since they have their own interests, they may also serve as a constraint to the president's goal. But at the end of the day, even though the president, we can say that the president cannot solve all the problems alone of this country, he should show us his kind of leadership. You know, he can lead by telling the members of Congress that this problem should be solved as soon as possible. And this is the importance of SONA.
Which leads me into asking you this question. How do you think, or what do you see, is the real relationship with the president and the Congress? Because what we're seeing now is, you mentioned earlier, it's a little alarming, because of the 42 priority bills, there only was three that was passed from that. It begs us to ask that question: is there really a unity if the Congress, even in the upper and the lower house, is already made up of a supermajority of allies by the president? Why then do we have only three of the 42 priority bills passed?
Well, I think that there's still a good relationship between the executive and the legislative department. It's just that every now and then, our congressmen, our senators are getting distracted with political issues. Say, for example, in the House of Representatives several months ago, there were news reports saying that there was a coup attempt in the leadership. So the cousin of President Marcos was going to be ousted, according to reports. And the one who was leading it was the former president, Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. So these the dynamics, they're not related to lawmaking. And they tend to distract our lawmakers. In the House of, in the Senate, they tend to undertake investigations. Of course, they would say they're in aid of legislation, but then again, one would think that considering the quality of their sessions, one would think that this is just a sessions are only meant for grandstanding and for media mileage. So. But if you're going to compare that, I tried to compare the performance of this current Congress with the past Congresses, and I noticed that they are, you know, that their performance is still on the average. So a Congress could produce, I think, 11 or 12 laws in a given Congress. So three would be on the average. But of course, if we're going to put it in its proper context, remember what I said earlier, that we are recovering from the pandemic. Our institutions, our leaders should work double time. So we don't need to have a mediocre government.
All right, we're pressed for time, Professor, but I have one more question that I need to ask from you because of what happened recently with former President Duterte visiting China and having an audience with Chinese President Xi Jinping. The dynamics between the two presidents, Marcos and Duterte, can we talk about this for a very quick while?
Yeah. I was wondering if the former president went there, at the behest or with the approval of the current president. Since I would assume that he has the approval of Bongbong Marcos, President Bongbong Marcos. Now the question there is, what is he doing there?
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking that probably President Bongbong Marcos is very concerned with the alarming behavior of China, of course, vis-a-vis the United States and vis-a-vis Taiwan. So China has issues with these two countries, and perhaps the current president is afraid that we might get affected. I mean, we might get involved in the rising tension between China and US and between China and Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
So that's probably what President Bongbong Marcos wants to convey to Xi Jinping through the former president. And he also probably would like to explain why we have received so many US officials in the Philippines and why we have become very close to the UN.
Mm-hmm.
Remember
right.
that
mm-hmm.
the policy of the president striking a balance between the two major powers. It's called a hedging strategy.
Mm-hmm. Again, political dynamics at play with what we're seeing now. And with that, I'll let you go. Professor Dennis Coronacion, thank you so much for your time, Professor. Good afternoon.
Thank you. Thank you.